something screwy around here.
Oh, Chief, I think we'll all have a groovy time.
It's the morning show. So don't forget to check out the morning show every weekday, 7 to 9 a.m.
Join me, Matt Connerton, weekdays, 4 to 6 p.m. live for a discussion about politics where we put aside labels like liberal and conservative and have a discussion about truth and what's really happening in the world.
This hour on WMNH is proudly sponsored by CGI Business Solutions, located at 171 Londonderry Turnpike in Hooksett, serving all your employee benefits planning, design and administration, investment and wealth management, and customized business insurance solutions. They are available at 866-841-4600 or on the web at cgibusinesssolutions.com.
You are listening to WMNHLP, Manchester's radio, broadcasting at 95.3 megahertz frequency modulation from the top of 1000 Elm Street. Our studios are located at 1045 Elm Street and licensed to Manchester Public Television Service in Manchester, New Hampshire, USA. Contact us by email at WMNH953@gmail.com or through our website at WMNHradio.org.
Hey, everybody, welcome. It's Matt Connerton, Unleashed in the Afternoon, live on WMNH 95.3 FM and Comcast 97 here in Manchester, New Hampshire, streaming at WMNHradio.org and on Facebook via Facebook Live on the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page. And we are diving right in today on this Thursday, March 21st, 2019, because joining us by phone once again is Dr. Richard A. Lahern, PhD, also known as Red. How are you, Red?
Doing just fine. I hope I'm audible.
You are. Yep. Can hear you loud and clear. So before we get rolling, just kind of give people some context who might not know. So we had Red on back on November 28th. This is Red's third appearance on the show. And we got a ton of positive feedback on that. And it's a very important issue, which we'll get into in a moment, that Red is advocating for. So we had a lot of Facebook Live activity that day in the chat room and so forth, people participating, asking questions, sharing their stories, et cetera. And then we had Red on again recently, and we were expecting, of course, once again, a lot of Facebook activity and so forth. But it ended up being, as fate would have it, the day of the global Facebook outage. So during that particular show, and it was still a great conversation, and it's up, you know, all the shows are archived at WMNHradio.org. But it's worth listening to. But unfortunately, because of the Facebook outage, we weren't able to send the show out on Facebook Live. You know, we were still on FM radio, and of course, the audio feed was streaming. But we didn't have that same participation with listeners that we did the previous time because of the Facebook issue. So now Red is back for a third time, and already we have, in the Facebook live chat, I see John Midas Manning in there, DJ Midas, who also has a show here on WMNH. Jenny is in there. Ryan Gorman is in there. Hello. I'm sure we'll have a lot more folks. Red, so far so good. No Facebook Live issues. I think we're good to go. And the other thing too that I just want people to know is, in case they didn't hear the show last time, when you were on, when we had the Facebook issue, since we had talked in November, just to kind of get people up to speed, because you're advocating for folks who, because of the government trying to quote unquote fix an alleged opioid problem. Since we had talked first, there had been a development with my own mother who might be listening. Hi, Mom, if you're listening. She might be listening online. She's in Wisconsin, where she is now experiencing an issue. She's cut off from the pain medication that she was on. She has chronic severe back pain. She was in a very, very bad car accident I think I was just a little tyke when that happened. That actually happened right here in Manchester on the Amiskeag Bridge. You know, so she's been living with chronic pain, most of her adult life. And she's now been cut off because the government said, we're not going to let your doctor prescribe to you anymore. So this is because of that, this has become deeply personal to me. You know, and I've seen plenty of other instances up close, too, of how this is affecting people. So I'm very excited to have you back on the show. And I'm glad that, this time we're actually streaming on Facebook and everything seems technologically sound on my end. So so hopefully we'll get a lot more people participating this time. But so that was my long-winded way of saying welcome back.
Well, thank you, Matt. And just as a humorous aside, when Murphy became so popular years ago, they used to say that Murphy was an optimist. However, when it comes to technology, Murphy was the head of an IT department.
Yes.
So I can sympathize. Something that I do, and I don't mean it to be repetitive to people who know who I am.
Sure.
In any venue, much like yours, where you get people who come in from local radio and who listen in, or who listen to your streaming services, I think I owe everybody kind of an acknowledgement of who I am and where I come from on the issues that we're talking about today, which is chronic pain and government misdirection and policy. Because I don't represent myself as a doctor of medicine. I'm not. I'm a doctor of engineering, which was UCLA in 1976 or so, a long, long time ago. And I had a long career, actually two careers, maybe three, depending on how you count them. First as an Air Force officer for 21 years, and then for another 22 years or so as an aerospace engineer, technologist, technology evaluator. But in 1996, my wife came down with an absolutely horrendous facial pain that we thought was a dental abscess, and it may have started as a dental abscess.
Okay.
But it turned into something that has a lot of characteristics that in their own way are a little bit like your mom is going through.
Mm-hmm.
And that is that it became chronic, and that's to say it lasted much longer than any dental abscess ever would, and it ultimately became permanent.
Mm.
And a lot of chronic pain patients are this way. So being a technologist, I went looking for information on this thing that was going on in her face, and eventually, through a long process, six doctors later, we got a diagnosis for a relatively rare kind of facial neuropathic pain, which is called trigeminal neuralgia. And the doctor who gave us that diagnosis at the time said, well, I know about this disorder, but I don't treat it. I want to send you to a support group that meets in our area and that was part of a national network of support groups. There's an awful lot more of them now.
Mm.
And there were 22 years ago in a lot of disorders. But I raised a hand and asked a question in the meeting, and the lady who heads organization, or did at that time head the organization, Claire Patterson, basically crooked a finger at me and said, come talk to me after the meeting. And a year later, I found myself as the webmaster on a national website for people that needed authoritative information on this particular disorder,
okay,
which is very rare and hard to find.
Yeah.
So I'm the husband and father of chronic pain patients. My daughter has Parkinson's.
Okay.
And has failed back surgery two or three times and probably going to go through it again. And I guess I see this perspective, or excuse me, I see this, the problem that people are discussing, and that's your mom has,
mm-hmm.
from a perspective of someone who, operating from goodwill, I don't have myself chronic pain. I merely have acquaintances through social media to the tune of now probably something over 40,000
Wow.
people in social media, and yeah. another 200,000 on Twitter who see my stuff, and I don't know how many who read my stuff because I'm widely published. And I hear from people who are experiencing the thing that your mom is experiencing.
Mm-hmm.
And I got concerned about, well, how, why are people being cut off from pain management or denied appointments from doctors or told when they go into an emergency room, well, we don't know exactly what's wrong with you, but we think you're a drug seeker and we're not going to treat you. Go home.
Something like that
and
happened
I'm
to Jenny.
I'm not exaggerating yeah. when I paint that picture, because that's exactly what has happened to any number of people that I've corresponded with.
Yeah, I've seen it happen. Yeah.
I'm hoping to do with you today, and this is to follow up on the two programs we've done already,
mm-hmm.
I'm hoping to be able to address some of the questions that people have about what is going on and how it has affected them, and from my perspective, what kinds of things are wrong with government policy, not only at the federal level, but in the 22 states or so who have decided to severely cut back on and discourage the use of opioid medications. And by that, I mean a whole class of medications that includes OxyContin and oxycodone and Percocet, and a number of other related type drugs that are considered to be narcotic drugs and are scheduled by the U.S. Drug Enforcement Administration, so that they have to be carefully regulated and reported whenever they're used.
Mm-hmm.
In that regard, there's one particular story I'd kind of like to tell you today, and I'm going to call something up on my own page so that I'm sure I get this right.
Okay. Actually, but before you do that, Red, I just want to acknowledge, because there's more people coming into the Facebook live chat. And you might know this is Rhonda Ostowitz. I don't know if that's someone you know, or Ostowitz. Favero. She says, hi, Matt and Red. So I don't know if that's someone you've communicated
sure.
with. That's a
Rhonda
new...
and I have communicated.
Okay, excellent.
And hello and welcome.
Excellent. Dr. Jeff Cassell is in there. Fred Bonig from thedailyripple.org. Chris Rose is in there. And Jenny made a comment, watch for writings and testimony from Red Lawhern, PhD. And you are, as you mentioned, you know, you're widely published. But, okay, I just wanted to acknowledge those folks. Go ahead.
Yeah, well, there's a story that I've recently published that I want to be sure we have the chance to share with people.
Yeah.
And a lot of those who follow me have probably seen this, but some of your non-Facebook centered folks who actually have a life, this is something I say from time to time, some will not have seen this, but, and I'm not going to read all of it. It's available, and it's been published in four different online groups up to now,
okay.
One of which was my LinkedIn network page. But it's been published on Pain News Network, on the American Council for Science and Health, and on the blog of the International Pain Foundation, which is run by a lady by the name of Barbie Engel. It was under different titles, but the one that I negotiated with Pain News Network was the one, it was this one. It was pain patients' death was state-sanctioned torture.
Yeah.
And this is the story of a lady who died in agony,
mm-hmm.
truly in agony. And the way this story got started was that someone who was a family friend came to me by a messenger in the Facebook page and said, you know, I'm trying to support and having a hard time dealing with the death of a woman by the name of Dawn Anderson and her struggles over a long, long time, which I've seen, she said
mm-hmm.
to me, to get pain treatment. And she was denied pain treatment for literally months and probably for years. That wasn't absolutely clear. The lady's name that just passed away was Dawn Anderson. And she is a rather she's a rather remarkably typical case.
Okay.
If I may, I'll read you just a little bit from this so
please.
That I don't get the details mushed.
Absolutely.
She was 53 years old. She had been a registered nurse and had done work in hospital. The family has granted me permission to share her story, and I want to do that.
Okay.
Because the story is both horrifying and it's very representative for an awful lot of people who are dealing with pain issues these days.
Mm-hmm.
And these are patients who have died in agony that was entirely avoidable.
Mm-hmm.
And the agony was caused by the publication of a prescribing guideline by the U.S. Centers for Disease Control, the Centers for Accident Prevention, in 2016. And that guideline is directly responsible for, in my belief, now this is an opinion because it's really hard to track
sure. The
detail, in my belief that guideline is not only fatally flawed, it is responsible for hundreds of suicides. Because it has driven hundreds of doctors out of pain management practice for fear that if they prescribe enough to help their patients when there's nothing else that works, and in many cases that's true, there is nothing else that isn't an opioid
mm-hmm.
that works.
Mm-hmm.
They're afraid that if they prescribe enough to help their patients, the DEA or local law enforcement is going to come after them. And even if they win a case that goes so far as to go into court, they know they will be ruined, and they know the DEA wants to ruin them so that
right.
they won't prescribe anymore.
Right.
Now,
that's that's
tough going.
By the way, that's the boat that my mother is in, because her doctor, who apparently is retiring soon, and I talked to him. He sounds like a very nice man, but he's in that exact situation, Red. You know, he's afraid to continue after prescribing to my mother for 2 decades. He's afraid to prescribe anymore for that exact reason.
Right. So, and I hear that. I hear that from a lot of people. As a matter of fact, I can say I personally have heard that story in the last 3 to 4 years from at least 1,000 people. This is not a narrowly defined problem.
Yeah.
It is endemic. That's to say, it is very, very common. It has spread across the entire U.S. It has involved multiple agencies. It's not just the CDC. It's involved the Drug Enforcement Administration.
Mm-hmm.
It's involved the state regulatory bodies in numerous states. One of the worst, of course, is Oregon, because Oregon Medicaid is trying to shut down the prescription of opioids and force people who are on them to taper to zero. At least they have been, and that issue is sort of up in the air right now.
Yeah, I remember.
But let me continue a little bit with Dawn's story, because
okay.
it's the kind of thing that chronic pain patients see in their own lives. And
yeah.
I want people who are here listening to us to hear my respect for the complication and difficulty that many of these people have, and that's your mom has.
Right.
Now, Dawn was diabetic, and she suffered from kidney disease. And she had other serious medical problems, one of which was MRSA, which is a very aggressive, very hard-to-treat infection that it kills quite a number of people.
Mm-hmm.
And Dawn had lost both of her legs and one eye
oh my God.
To diabetic neuropathy. And she had had severe pain for many years, but until some months ago, probably 6 months to a year ago is my reading. It might have been longer. She was told by her doctor that he couldn't continue to prescribe for her. And she went to any number of different other doctors trying to get answers
mm-hmm.
and trying to get help to continue opioid prescriptions that had been working for her fairly well and had given her a quality of life that allowed her to be with relatives and to talk with people. And now and then to get out, but that wasn't going to continue because nobody would either take her on as a pain patient, or if they did, they would not treat her with any dose of opioids that amounted to more than 50 to 90 morphine milligram equivalent daily dose per day. And basically, what she heard from pain management people was, well, we're going to transition you to addiction treatment with Suboxone, or maybe, in some cases, from some of these people, I can give you cortisone shots in your back because we know that's where a lot of your pain is concentrated. But there was a little problem with that, and that is that Dawn knew that Suboxone would not treat her pain.
Mm-hmm.
And she also knew from being a nurse and seeing it in practice that there's a fairly serious risk with cortisone shots because for some people they make the pain worse they cause additional medical conditions.
Okay.
One of which is a long-term called adhesive arachnoiditis, which is basically a problem with the spinal column or the spinal cord beginning to attach itself to nearby structures because the cortisone has done something to the spinal cord and the dura of the spinal cord.
Oh my God.
So what did she do? Well, eventually she found somebody that would treat her. And that somebody was a doctor by the name of Madison, who it later turned out was successfully sued, actually prosecuted by the DEA, for Medicare fraud.
Okay.
And for prescribing huge amounts of opioid medications, like 1.2 million doses over a period of a year and a half to the people that were seeing him. And he operated offices in 12 states, and he has been convicted of Medicare fraud, and he's out of business. But really, Dr. Madison isn't the problem, because for every Dr. Madison we see, the ones that are really, who are operating pill mills, if that's what he was doing, and I can't confirm that I know that he was operating a pill mill. I don't want to be unfair to the doctor. But for those who have been accused, for every one of them that's accused, there are 100 doctors, or maybe 10 to 100 doctors who have said, oh, I can't go through this.
Right, exactly.
If the DEA comes after me, my practice is going to be ruined, even if I win.
Exactly. Yep.
So the situation that I spoke to was one where I talked to the family friend who had talked with Dawn, and then I talked with with Dawn's daughter. And here's what basically happened. On March the 4th, just this month, this year, the family friend talked to Dawn, and she was very tired. She wasn't feeling well. Her husband had been calling her from work throughout the day just to be sure she was all right. And when she didn't answer, he called the police department and asked for a wellness check. When the police arrived, they found Dawn had fallen out of her wheelchair and was unconscious on her living room floor. She was transported to a hospital, and when she came to, she was very confused.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't quite know where she was or what was going on. Now, hospital physicians, and these are people she'd never seen before.
Right.
They figured out that Dawn had a pretty severe urinary tract infection, and her kidneys were failing. She was admitted to the intensive care unit, and the doctor ordered that she be put on a dialysis tube to try to flush her kidneys and keep her from dying. They also, when she refused dialysis, the staff held her down and forced her to take Thorazine injections because she was judged to be incompetent to run her own affairs.
Oh, my God.
And she wound up covered in bruises due to the force that was used in pinning her down to administer those injections.
Well, by the way, so what does Thorazine do? Like, what was their rationale for even doing that?
Thorazine is an antipsychotic.
Okay.
It is used commonly in people who are having hallucinations. And one of the older antipsychotics.
Okay.
And it doesn't have any effect on pain particularly.
Okay.
It wasn't for her pain. It was supposedly to help her come out of her confusion and start thinking rationally by the estimate of the doctors. At least that's my understanding of what went on there.
Okay.
Realize that this is not always absolutely precise.
Sure.
But here's the drill. When she was in the hospital, Dawn was eventually removed from intensive care to a hospital room, and her daughter called the family friends so that Dawn would be able to talk to somebody that she liked and trusted. And that conversation was very, very difficult, and I knew this from the lady that actually talked to her. The friend asked why Don was refusing paralysis, and she replied, and I'm quoting her now, "I just can't take it anymore." Now, she anticipated that she would have new issues with dialysis, but the most important issue was her pain, because the hospital had again, even after this admission, refused to provide her treatment with opioid pain relievers. Now, Dawn and her friend were in tears during that call.
Yeah,
but Dawn was very adamant. She said, "Honey, I love you, but I can't suffer anymore.
Yeah.
The pain is unbearable, and I just can't fight anymore.
Yeah.
If you keep begging me, I will hang up with you." Now, the friend and the family had talked about her entering hospice care. And she knew that if she did enter hospice care, she would at least be given comfort medication.
Right, right.
That's what hospice does.
Yeah.
And she left the hospital, and one day later, she died. And she died after having been placed on comfort care and given adequate pain control. She passed, finally.
Okay.
But there's a lesson in all of this. And that is that Don should never have been forced to find a pill mill in the first place. And the only reason she was forced to do so is that the DEA has been persecuting doctors out of practice, and the CDC has given the DEA the ammunition they use to say that any doctor who prescribes more than a fixed amount, which is really quite a modest amount, I might add, 90 MMED isn't much.
Yeah.
Any doctor who prescribes more than that is automatically over-prescribing and should be investigated.
Oh, jeez.
That's the DEA's attitude, even though they don't, and I might add, I want to be clear about this, they
right.
don't claim that attitude in anything written that I see.
Well, of course.
They do reference the CDC guidelines from 2016
yeah.
in some of the responses that they've made to people. So what I'm telling, and in this story, it's pretty clear, the story that it was carried by Pain News Network and by the International Pain Foundation and others. The conditions which created Dawn's desire to die rather than to fight the pain further were a natural consequence of the CDC's refusal to reconsider the horrid outcomes of their CDC guidelines published in 2016. These folks have doubled down on a document that is biased and is known widely by medical practitioners to be biased. It is based on weak evidence and lousy science. It is completely silent on the fact that pain, there is no one-size-fits-all pain patient.
Of course, yeah.
It is completely silent on the fact that pain patients may have a very wide range of the minimum effective dose of medications that will help them. And moreover, the guidelines have declared, and this comes all the way back from the original now, the guidelines declared that there are alternatives to opioids that are safer and are just as effective. And that is a damned lie. And I'm not going to call it anything else.
Right.
It is a damned lie for one basic reason, and that is that the non-opioid medications are things like ibuprofen.
Right.
And Tylenol. And we know that for really severe pain, they don't work. And
and
patients have reported this in the tens of thousands.
Oh, of course.
For really severe pain,
of course.
You can't give somebody Tylenol after a major surgery.
Right.
And expect them to come out of this and be comfortable enough to function. It's not going to happen.
Right, right.
The other part of this that's important, and I'm going to, take a breath for just a minute here.
Yeah.
If you want to break in, and I'm not giving you room, Matt, do a little break with me. And
yeah.
I'll shut up and listen. But to complete this thought.
Yeah, yeah.
To complete this thought. The so-called non-invasive, non-pharmacological, which is to say non-drug therapies, that CDC seems to have so much confidence in, have not completed a single phase 2 or phase 3 multi-center trial. Not one.
Okay.
And that what I mean about these therapies, we're talking about acupuncture and creative visualization and psychological counseling and rational cognitive therapy and quite a number of others. Even aromatherapy, as a matter of fact, has been looked at by some people.
Sure.
And it turns out that there's a master report that was issued June of last year by the American Health and Research Quality.
Okay.
The Agency for Health and Research Quality, AHRQ. That's a hard one to remember. And they did a tremendous year-long review of the literature on these non-opioid solutions for pain. When you read that document, what it says is they reviewed almost 5,000 published reports. And the quality of that literature was so horrible and so poorly grounded that they were only able to deep dive about 220 of those reports.
Yeah. Wow.
And that's to say, to go in deep.
Yeah.
When they did the deep dive those reports, what they found was that in these therapies, there generally are some people, some of the time, who benefit from them, and there are others who don't.
Right, right.
And that's not a big surprise.
Right.
And we shouldn't be surprised by that.
Or some of those things
might
be
supportive.
What's really interesting
is that when you read that report, and you read it carefully, which I did,
yeah,
and later published on it, when you read the report, you find out that the conclusions they drew do not reflect the details they reported. Because they drew much more optimistic conclusions, which it appears were the only thing that CDC read,
yeah,
than the actual reports when you analyze the information behind them and you find out what actually they talk about.
Yeah, so
because
they spin it.
One of the big weaknesses in this literature is that most of the time the non-opioid therapies are given to people who are continued on whatever program of regular therapy they
right.
had to begin with.
Right. Yeah.
And that means what you've got is a mixture of effects, and it's really hard to know how much of the improvement in their pain was due to placebo effect, which is really, in many cases, just a matter of having somebody pay serious attention to what you're reporting. Because people do better when they have a good relationship with their doctor.
Of course. Of course, yeah.
It's not rocket science.
Yeah, narrative medicine.
And that relationship often involves just listening to them and hearing what their issues are.
Right.
So we don't know how much of the improvements that were reported were a result of just placebo effect, and we don't really know what the dose levels of opioids and non-opioids were that were continued while these other therapies were administered.
Right.
So we know there was general benefit for some people some of the time, but we
sure.
don't have any idea how reliable it is, and we have no basis whatever
right.
for demanding that these non-opioid therapies be substituted
right.
by state mandate.
Right. Right.
For the real thing.
Yeah. I mean, it's probably reasonable that some of them might be good for supporting, you know, if you're on some sort of pain medication and maybe one of these alternative therapies is helping to support that to help you feel better, but not as a replacement, clearly.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Now, that takes us to another issue, but I want to give room for the people who are asking specific
yeah.
questions just from where they've just come from. So
yeah, we do
there
have
anything
a,
coming off of Facebook that we ought to address?
We do have some folks. Tim Farndon says, a lot of respect for Red Lawhern with the phenomenal amount of work he does. Thank you for having him on your show. Listening on Facebook in the UK. Oh, wonderful, Tim. Thank you so much. Let's see. We've got... hello to Bill Muckler, who joins us in the Facebook live chat. He says, good afternoon, Matt. Carol Becker is in there, says hello. Let's see. Jenny says, I want to cry. It means death is going to be agony no matter what we do. It's a choice of long-term or short-term agony for most with reflex sympathetic dystrophy, among others. I wanted to say too, Red, and I know I think I'd said this the last time that you were on, but, you know, when talking about, you know, those who would suggest using ibuprofen or aspirin or something, Jeff Sessions, our former U.S. Attorney General,
was quoted as one saying, because he's very anti-cannabis, including medical cannabis. And he's actually on record, and personally, I think Jeff Sessions is a sociopath. And this comment that he made, I think, demonstrates that. He's on record as saying, well, you know, if you have cancer and you're suffering, you should just be taking aspirin, and that'll help you to feel better. He literally said that. That's not even me paraphrasing. And, you know, I think it's I think for a lot of folks in government and maybe at the CDC and wherever else, it's I think also, and maybe just in life in general, it's always easier to make judgments and assessments of others who are on some sort of medication, who are maybe in pain. You know, until you're actually experiencing something like that yourself, it's easy for people to be just kind of flippant about it, like Jeff Sessions, for example. And not, you know, maybe it's just a lack of empathy among people. I don't know. But I also, too, I remember talking to you about part of why we get into these situations where the government gets involved in something that they have no business sticking their noses in is, you know, you have these, and we've seen it here in New Hampshire. You have these politicians who have to, you know, they have to look like they're doing something. So, for example, the heroin crisis, you know, they want to look like they're responding to that in some way. So they, you know, so they start sticking their noses into this stuff and getting the government involved and saying, well, it's all about the opioids. So now we have to start regulating these doctors. And it because it doesn't matter to them. And I think I'd made this comment to you before because I remember you kind of laughing when I said it, that, you know, in terms of having a successful political career, you know, and ascending up the ladder to higher and higher office, there's a certain amount of sociopathy involved. So these folks, it doesn't matter to them if what they're doing does more harm than good. That's irrelevant. They just have to look like they're doing something, and that something that they're doing has to look good in a campaign ad when it's time for their reelection or election to higher office, and they can say, oh, look what I did about this problem. It may have been a solution in search of a problem, or it may have been a terrible solution, but don't worry about that. Just look at what I did and vote for me. And, you know, people fall for that very easily because there's a lot of brainwashed lemmings in the United States. I don't know if you've noticed. But, you know, so that works. That's a very successful strategy for politicians and these government sociopaths who do these things that directly harm the American people. And but I'm an anti-drug war guy in the macro, too. I oppose the drug war. I call it the government's war against the American people. Actually, I heard someone else say that, and I keep repeating it, and I can't give credit to whoever said it before because I don't remember who it was. But that's how I view it. And well, so I think Matt, that's part of how we ended up here. Yeah, go ahead.
Matt, let me take a little bit or two of your thesis, if you will. There,
sure,
the points you're making.
Yeah.
First of all, as I told you when we last spoke, my opinion of the former attorney general it tends to align pretty thoroughly with yours.
Yeah.
And basically, I have to be kind of careful about the language I use on that, or you'll have to bleep out half of what I say. But apart from that,
yeah.
Unfortunately, there are quite a number of people in government policymaking positions who are not necessarily people of ill will. They just believe things that are stupid.
Right.
And one of the things that they believe most that is stupid is something they've been led into by advocates that want themselves to suppress opioids for their own financial benefit. And by that, I include people like the participants in the group that's called Physicians for Responsible Opioid Prescribing, otherwise shortened to PROP, and notably Andrew Kolodny, who is a former public health official from the state of New York and a psychiatrist who has no board certification in anything other than psychiatry. But he's been very active, and he's basically propagandized a tremendous number of people who don't bother to check his lack of qualifications and who have listened to him when he has said on video that OxyContin is just a variety of heroin.
Oh, jeez. Wow.
He regards, or at least the positions that he has avowed in public, have been to the effect that opioids that are used in medical practice are so dangerous that we should just see them as legal forms of deadly drugs that are being used recreationally everywhere else.
Mm.
Now, that's not a direct quote, so be careful with
sure.
that. I don't want to misrepresent what he's actually said. Sure.
But
that is the impact of what he said. And he had a tremendous impact on what the CDC wrote. He and a colleague by the name of Jane Ballantyne made a lot of input to several people who sat on the writers' group. And they had the help of Tom Friedman, who at that time was the director of the CDC. Because what Tom Friedman did when they convened their little guideline process was he basically told these people, you've got to find a way to help us solve the opioid crisis. And since prescription drugs caused it, you've got to find a way to make people use less. And that also is not a direct quote. It is simply a synopsis of what I believe happened.
Mm-hmm.
And in this regard, we're talking about opinion now. We're not talking about fact. It's an opinion that's grounded on a whole lot of things and an awful lot of published work, but it's not a direct quote, so I don't want to misrepresent
sure.
what he actually did.
Sure.
So all of this started with an idea about why it was that people were increasingly dropping dead in the streets mm-hmm. and elsewhere because of opioids that they were addicted to. And the idea was something that a friend of mine up in Canada calls the poster boy theory of drug abuse. And the poster boy theory takes this kind of line on things. That theory says, my kid Johnny went to the dentist to have a wisdom tooth taken out, and he was given a bottle of Percocets to take home after the procedure to last for a week, and he started taking those Percocets pretty much full time right then and there, and he was addicted within just a matter of days. Well, I got news for anybody that tells that story. That's also a damned lie.
Yeah.
One of the things that we now know, and this is directly, and I believe it's a fair quote, or at least a fair paraphrase, and please hear that too. I'm not reading this.
Yeah.
There's a lady by the name of Dr. Nora Volkow who has headed up the National Institute on Drug Abuse, NIDA, for quite some years, and she is well published and widely published in a lot of places. She and another doctor, PhD type, named McMillan, a couple of years ago did a piece in which she said, opioid abuse is not a predictable outcome of prescription, period. And the rest of her article was addressing other mythologies about opioids.
Mm-hmm.
Now, they were doing this on the basis of their own knowledge of the field and their own practices in addiction management and the research of many others that were associated with NIDA that looks at, you know, who becomes an addict, who becomes a person with addiction, which
right.
is a better way to phrase this.
Right, right.
And I got interested in this, and by accident, because I'm such a blabbermouth, somebody saw a little thing on Twitter one day from a fellow by the name of John Allen Tucker, who is a business analyst. And John had gotten interested in the relationship between rates of prescribing opioids by doctors versus rates of overdose-related deaths from all sources. And when it's all sources, what we mean is from legal drugs that somebody actually gave a pain patient or diverted drugs that somebody took from a pain patient or that a doctor provided to a pill mill or from illegal drugs, street drugs. And he lumped all of those sources of opioid-related mortality together.
Mm-hmm.
And state by state, he compared the rate of opioid-related mortality to the rate of opioid prescription. Now, I don't know how many people in your audience have the link up to your Facebook page, but those who have should be able to page down in the page just a couple of postings, because there were two charts that I put in there that really illustrate the kind of problem that John Allen Tucker found, and that he and I together wrote an analysis report on. When you do this kind of plot, people have been saying for the last almost 10 years that because the rate of opioid prescribing has gone up, the rate of opioid-related death has gone up too. And the problem with that statement is the word because. And
yeah.
The reason it is a problem is that it ain't true.
Right.
Now, there's two charts on the Facebook page that are really kind of good. At least I hope they are. And I hope that they will be taken and downloaded and presented to doctors all over this country with a request from those who do the presenting. Okay, tell me what these charts are about, doctor, and tell me how it is that you come to the conclusion that overprescribing has caused our opioid crisis, because these charts disprove it.
And by the way, for I just want to say, Red, for people who are listening to us on Facebook, I'm reposting those charts too right now, so it'll be right at the top of the Facebook page. I tried to put them in the Facebook live chat. Apparently, I can't do that, but I am reposting them just so people can find them real quick and easy right at the top. Okay, go ahead.
Great. So I'll explain to those of you who are not looking at Facebook what these charts are about. The idea here is that anytime you measure stuff over a wide variety of conditions, you're not going to get a straight line or a neat curved line that says everything lines up just exactly with this curve. You're going to get some what's called splatter. It's just statistical variation. It means basically that if one data set is related to another data set, they're probably going to clump up a little bit around some central trend line. And the first of the charts that I offered, Matt, was a kind of notional chart between an x-axis and a y-axis. That's just a grid, if you're not particularly immersed in science. And it says, let's say I've got two sets of data, and I plot them one against the other.
Mm-hmm.
Each of the dots on the chart is a data point. And it's a relationship between whatever variable x is and whatever variable y is. And if they line up and there is some kind of relationship between them, what you'll typically see is that when x increases, y is going to vary in some way, and it may be kind of an orderly variation. It won't all be exactly on the line, but there'll be kind of a pattern of dots that
mm-hmm.
seems to follow some sort of a general trend.
Right.
Now, I also want to be kind of careful to say that doesn't necessarily mean that Y is caused by X, because you can get the same thing when both Y and X are caused by Z that you don't even see.
Right.
But at least it says there probably is a relationship. Now, what John Allen Tucker did and what he and I wrote about was he took all of the data from 17 years of data in the CDC Wonder database on prescribing rates by state and opioid-related deaths from all sources by state. And he plotted those data on a single chart. And he did it for like three representative years. And the chart that you've just put up is for one of those years, the most recent, 2016.
Okay.
And when you look at this chart, what you get is a whole series of green dots, but they look like somebody took a shotgun and took a poke at somebody's barn door.
Right.
There is no trend line in the data at all, and
yeah.
There is a tremendous spread. You have a variation in the number of prescriptions per 100 from state to state that ranges between 25 and 120 prescriptions per 100 people. And you have a variation in the deaths related to opioids per 100,000 population that ranges anywhere from 8 deaths per 100,000. And by the way, that's a number that looks like 0.00008.
Right.
It ain't a very big number.
No.
It runs from 0.00, from 8 deaths per 100,000 to a maximum of 50. And 50 is kind of an outlier. Most of them are below 40. And you run a line through them that's called a regression line, and it's almost flat.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't rise from right to left. And what this data tells us is not only are deaths per 100,000 not caused by RXs per 100 or prescriptions per 100, not only are they not caused, they're not even related.
Right. Yeah.
And what I'm suggesting here, and this is something that I'll reemphasize, and I know I'm repeating some of the things that we said in our last conversation.
No, that's okay, because I'm sure we have a lot of new listeners, so don't
worry
about it.
For the audience, and for the newbies who maybe have tuned in, and for, I hope, the press that I'm eventually going to hear from on this.
Yeah.
For all of these folks, what I'm saying is the CDC is running from this data. I have sent the CDC 11 different letters asking for an email address where I can send the data set that these charts were, that this chart was originated from, to have their people look at it.
Mm-hmm.
And they haven't sent me an email address, and what they did send me made it obvious they had not read the analysis that I referred them to that has already been published.
What did they say?
They're not interested in reading it.
What did they send you?
Just completely contradicts the basis for their CDC guidelines. It basically says, guys, you messed up so big time that you can't even recover from this. You just ought to pull these guidelines off and repudiate them like the AMA did.
Right. What did they send you, Red? Was it just kind of a generic email like, hey, thanks for submitting this or something?
It got to be a little more than generic. It was sent to me by somebody in the Centers for Accident Prevention.
Oh, okay.
And it put together stuff that it looked to me like they had probably sent to other places in a kind of, well, grab this and grab that and put it together in a form letter, but brush him off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And when you read it, what you realize is that the party who looked at it, he did do pretty much what you just said, except that he put a few more details on it.
Okay.
and he basically said, without saying so, it's an art, believe me. He said, without saying so, well, you can't possibly be right, so we're not going to bother to look.
Mm-hmm.
And the horrifying thing is that I've had a couple of other people who are medical and mathematical professionals go through this data, and what they tell me is, yeah, the data says exactly what you say the data says.
Right, right.
The CDC is running from its own data, which disproves the silly notion that doctors helping their patients have caused our opioid crisis. It's not true, and they know it's not true.
Yeah.
And they've doubled down on their original message behind the CDC guidelines, and they are refusing even to conduct a review of the outcome. And that's not a quote from anybody. That's what they're doing by stonewalling all of the criticism they've gotten.
Right.
You know, there was a letter published in the Journal of Pain Medicine, which is very prominent in this field, that was signed by over 200 medical organizations and medical professionals. And what they told the CDC was, guys, you got to pull these guidelines because they're destroying lives, and you got to reconsider them on original principles because they're wrong. And you also need to consider that there is no evidence whatever that if patients are taken off opioids, they do better than when they're on opioids.
Mm-hmm.
Now, something that letter in pain medicine didn't say, that I have been saying, and it's one of the reasons I've got so much stuff published, is there was a letter from a group at Stanford University, including some of the folks that later signed the pain medicine letter, to the governor of Oregon, because the Oregon folks are trying to force taper everybody who's taking opioids off of them in order to be eligible for Medicaid, because Medicaid doesn't want to go on reimbursing doctors who prescribe them.
Is this legislation that's actually passed in Oregon, or is this something they're trying to do, or what? Where are we with that?
Trying to do. It hasn't passed yet. It's
okay.
Being handled by a health commission.
Okay.
And they recently had to suspend their operations, waiting for an external review, because it turned out one of the people that was involved in putting all of this together had professional conflict of interest, because he had worked for one of the groups that was trying to get alternative therapies qualified as a replacement for opioids.
Go figure.
Isn't that an interesting wrinkle? So, you know, one of the people that was actually supporting the health commission essentially was working on behalf of an organization that stood to benefit from the things he was advocating. That doesn't make him a very good public advocate, that's for sure.
No, and it's not.
I suspect that is just the tip of the iceberg. I suspect that just about everybody on the Oregon Health Commission, one way or another, has an interest, either professional or financial, in suppressing opioids.
Now, always.
I won't see everyone, because you can't make that generalization.
Right.
I don't know that.
Always
but
follow the money.
Enough of them have that kind of conflict of interest that somebody ought to say to them, as Stanford University people and several others said to them, stop.
Yeah.
There's no medical evidence for doing what you're talking about doing under mandate.
Right.
When you force people off opioids, you place them in danger of medical collapse, and there is nothing out there that justifies this kind of action.
And just
period. It's not there. Stop.
And just to be clear, what Oregon is trying to do, it's everybody? This would affect everybody who's
on?
In
this case, it's Medicare. Oregon Medicare
D
reimbursement.
Oh, okay.
And in fact, this is true in all states. Each state regulates the standards under which Medicaid, not Medicare. I'm sorry. I need to get that straight. Medicaid is different from Medicare.
I always get that mixed up, too.
Medicaid is reimbursed by the state. It's financed by the state.
Yeah.
And in this case, it's a health commission that is trying to change the rules for something over 1 million patients in Oregon only.
Wow.
There's another little wrinkle. I've used that term wrinkle in your past programs. I shouldn't do that.
That's,
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
There's another aspect of this.
Oh, there you go. Okay, we'll go with
it's
aspect.
It's a wrinkle, too, because it's a fold in the cloth that people are falling down into.
Yeah.
March of last year, the Centers for Medicaid and Medicare published a rule change to the Medicare Part D and Medicare Advantage insurance providers. And what they told the providers was that the providers were authorized to impose what they called safety edits.
Safety what?
And they would have to go out and develop procedures and training and all of that for providers and for prescribers and for pharmacists. And the idea was that at 90 MMED, the insurance providers could, if they chose, tell prescribers that before they could tell pharmacists, before you fill a prescription that shows up in your state prescription drug management program, for a patient is taking more than 90 per day, you really ought to go back and talk to the doctor that made the prescription and be sure that's what he intended, he or she intended, that he knows that these other doctors have prescribed and that the patient is fairly high-dose patient. That might make a lot of sense to you, but they said one more thing.
Mm-hmm.
And that was at 200 MMED, which is a fairly significant dose. It's still not by any means a maximum. It's still quite significant. At that dose level, you, Mr. Insurer, are hereby authorized to deny the filling of any prescription that will put a pain patient in the situation of having more opioids than the 200 MMED prescription threshold. You can actually deny that prescription. You can deny the refill, or at least you can deny reimbursement through Medicare.
Yeah.
If the patient can pay for the prescription, that's all well and good. That they have to negotiate with you.
But so that's a scenario where that's not even a taper if in that scenario, right? I mean, because someone could be on that medication, and then all of a sudden they can't get the refill. Like, they're just
they're just done.
Well, what they basically do, they did, and I got to be a little careful about this because
sure.
I don't want to be unfair. I don't want to paint these people as doing something quite that horrible. They do include in their rules provision for the prescriber to gradually taper the patient under some recommended program of taper.
Mm, how generous.
If their prescription rate is over 200. But basically, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services forgot a nasty, inconvenient truth, and that is that an awful lot of other prescription and health care plans take their rules from Medicare.
Mm-hmm.
And the other inconvenient truth that they forgot and haven't been responding to since is that there are over a million patients in this country that are being maintained on more than 200 NMED.
Mm-hmm.
Just in Medicare. And I don't know
right.
what the numbers look like overall, but it's
right,
got to be
course.
More than 3 million people.
Yeah.
Because there are 20 million people in this country who are on regular prescriptions for invasive, high-impact pain.
Sure.
Now, we get another interesting input to this. There's a paper that's fresh out. It's a short report in the Journal of the AMA, I think. It's either them or the New England Journal of Medicine, and I forget which one it is. I should have looked it up. There's a paper that says, well, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid have for a long time been concerned that some patients might be getting too much opioid therapy, and dangerously so, because we're concerned that maybe opioids cause addiction or drug misuse, and we want to be sure that doesn't happen. So they put a program in to monitor the prescription drug monitoring programs and the number of pharmacies that each patient in Medicare is prescribed through. And they talk about basically a protection from overprescribing. Well, a bunch of very astute medical researchers looked at, I think it was 3 or 4 years of data, with at least 360,000 medical records from Medicaid,
mm-hmm.
or excuse me, Medicare, in each year, and they looked at the criteria for patients that were being prescribed in high numbers and over 200 morphine milligram equivalent, or who had prescriptions that were from multiple pharmacies and multiple prescribers. These are the people that most states regard as high risk. What these investigators found was that the criteria that CMS had been using had very limited predictive value. About 30% to 50% of the people that they identified, and it was very small numbers of people they identified. It was like 1,000 or 1,400 out of 365,000. Very limited numbers of people later had a diagnosis within a year to a year and a half of opioid use disorder or any indication of hospital admission for overdose.
Okay.
So what this paper found, and we can locate it. As a matter of fact, I've remarked on it. I've circulated it to a lot of our medical professionals. What this paper shows us is that the criteria that just about all of the state regulators are using when they use data that's in a prescription drug monitoring program really don't help. At least they don't help more than about half of the people who might be at risk.
Mm-hmm.
But when you put this data out there and you tell prescribers, well, this patient has a really, really high level of prescription and they may be a danger, every patient that is prescribed more than the threshold of interest to the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid is likely to be looked at very, very carefully by insurers.
Right, right.
And they're likely to be denied, just like your mother was, for the same reason.
Yeah.
Because the pharmacist is afraid of being challenged.
Right, exactly.
So the pharmacist takes the safe way out.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, Jeez.
Now, so I've told you a little bit about Don Anderson, and I've told you a little bit about some of the foolishness in the CDC.
Yeah.
Before we go further, what else is coming up on the Facebook page? What do you want to relate?
Well, let's see. So we've got Don McDonaldson is in the Facebook live chat. She says the public is clueless to think that people would like to be homebound and you know, no quality of life and isolate away from friends and family. This is not the life I imagined at 30 years old. I wouldn't wish chronic pain on anyone. We are not addicts. I was on the same exact amount of medicine for almost 12 years until the DEA scared my doctor. Yep. She also says, Red, thank you for speaking up for the pain community. Most of us are too sick or don't know how to. You're a wonderful person. Very nice.
that's nice to hear.
That
thank
is,
you.
Yes, that's very nice. Jeannie Sunday says, I suffer severe and continuous pain with opioid pain relief. I gain mobility. Without, I'm in bed and in torturous pain. Hello to Susan Dwyer in there who was saying Medicaid. That's just referring to earlier. I make that same mistake, by the way. I mix up Medicaid and Medicare. Linda Rollins says, we are so fortunate to have Red Lawhern advocating for us. So very nice. Getting some love in the Facebook live chat. And if you're just...
I think I would also like to... I'd like to kind of do a riff, if you will, on that... on that kind of feedback.
Yeah.
And this is for people who do follow me and for others who may want to decide to. It's nice to have the feedback, and I don't in any way minimize it. Let's understand where it comes from. Pain patients who have been disregarded and denied treatment or deserted by their doctors or are told, you've got to taper down because I can't put my license at risk.
Mm-hmm.
Are some of the most ignored and marginalized people that we know. And there are hundreds of thousands of them. So realize I don't reach all of you. Nobody does. I don't know all of it. Nobody does.
Right.
But what I do know is grounded on a very healthy respect for medical evidence. And I am doing something that is a little unusual. It's not by any means unique, because there are other people who are doing it too, but you don't see much of it. Some of the people who are doing it on Twitter, and not everybody uses Twitter. Some of the people are doing it professionally and quietly because they don't want to have all hell break loose in their lives when somebody's
right.
saying, oh, no, 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 he's too effective, or she's too effective as an advocate. We better find a reason to investigate him.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying that's necessarily happened, but it is a kind of fear that some people have.
I'm sure it happens.
I even talked to patients who were telling me, I'll share my experience with you, but please don't ever attribute it to me by name because I'm afraid my doctor will discharge me automatically if he ever sees it.
That's a reasonable
and
concern.
I'm hearing that from thousands of people.
Yeah, yeah. That's a reasonable concern.
And I reach
have,
thousands
yeah.
of people every day.
Yeah.
So what I want to say to people who are in that boat is you are not alone.
Yeah.
And I want to have the feeling behind that for you are not alone, and you don't have to be alone. And
right.
others, of whom I am only one, are working to change this narrative. And part of what we're doing is trying to reach out to people that are in your very situation, and we're reaching out to you to say, okay, we know you sometimes don't quite know what to do. But there are things you can do that make a difference.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things you can do, by the way, is you can write a letter after you look up a certain senator by the name of Gillibrand.
Oh,
you
yes.
You can write a letter to Senator Gillibrand, who is the author, or rather co-author, of a piece of legislation that's now being considered and discussed.
I'm dropping a link to that in the Facebook live chat, by the way. I'm dropping a link for that in the Facebook live chat, by the way, so people listening on Facebook can see it.
That was good of you.
I had that article up and ready. Jenny had sent it to me, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, right, she did. And what happened here was Gillibrand and a co-author, and it's a brand new senator, and I can't think what the heck her name is right now. I'm sorry. But Gillibrand and her co-author, another senator, have put forward legislation.
Cory Gardner.
That would limit on a national level the duration of prescriptions for acute pain to a maximum of 7 days nationwide. And she's doing that because she claims that we have to do something about doctor overprescribing for things that shouldn't require a prescription for more than 7 days. And the example that she uses is that nobody should get a prescription for 30 days of OxyContin after they have a tooth removed. The thing that is really deadly here, and I believe it is actually literally deadly,
mm-hmm.
is there are large numbers of medical patients who go through an experience such as total hip replacement,
mm-hmm.
or they have an acute incident of pain that happens in the context of their being treated for years for chronic pain, or they go through surgery for, well, let's say total knee replacement. And for those people, they have acute pain, and it's acute post-surgical pain, but 7 days ain't anywhere near adequate.
Exactly.
And worse yet, those people aren't mobile. When they're home after this kind of surgery, they're barely hobbling around if they're able to get out of bed. And you want to drag them back to a doctor's office?
We should remind
them. What were you thinking, Senator?
Well, Red, we know. I'll tell you what she was thinking. She's running for president. And, you know, like I said earlier, you know, upward mobility in politics requires you to look like you're doing something. Doesn't matter if it's helping or hurting or whatever. So she's trying to, this is her way of, it's part of her campaign. Clearly, that's what she's doing.
May I be a little bit more kind to the lady, please?
Oh, feel free.
No, I want to be careful about, I want to be careful in what we say.
Yeah.
I'm not just taking pot shots.
Yeah.
I am, and I have actually responded to an article that she put out on medium.com, where what she basically says is, hey, I want feedback from patients. I want to get this right. We do have a really genuine opioid crisis, and I want to try to do something to help solve it.
Okay.
And I want to acknowledge the senator's good intentions. But what I've recommended to her, and I've offered my own services to her on this, I don't know whether I'll ever hear back a darn thing, but I gave her my email address if she's interested.
Yeah.
What I said to her was, you're operating under the unfortunate belief system that prescriptions are the problem, and they aren't.
Right, right.
And I will help you to see that if you're willing to reconsider your assumptions.
Right.
And that's not a direct quote either. That's basically just the substance of what I said to her.
Sure, sure.
Now, I didn't do that just to tick the lady off, and I didn't do it just to try to rain on her parade.
Yeah.
Because she's got a whole bunch of company among people in the House and Senate.
Oh, absolutely.
Who are basically people struggling with the idea, and I'm not going to put on them the idea that anybody will say anything if it gets them reelected.
Right.
I don't have to go that far. What I'm saying
is, you're more diplomatic than
I. People have been propagandized, and they've been very actively propagandized by people like Andrew Kolodny and Jane Ballantyne and a lady by the name of Krebs, who operates out of Michigan, and several others. They've been actively propagandized and told the problem is prescriptions. The problem is prescriptions over and over and over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't hear anything else for a long, long time. And people pointed out that when prescribing went up in the early 2000s, opioid deaths went up at the same time. And they especially went up until a period of about 2010. But they haven't been told the other side of the story.
Yeah.
So they've gotten a one-sided picture from the people who are loudest. And the people who are loudest are being paid by insurance companies to suppress opioids.
Of course. Follow the money. Yeah, absolutely.
Follow the money. So
yeah.
What I'm saying to the senator and to others is, we're not going to make threats with you. That's not what we're here about.
Right.
We realize you want to do something effective, and we think we understand what you can do that will be useful, and it's not what you're doing now.
Right. Yeah.
And that's the same group of people who passed the Support Act last, what was it, last September, about. The Support Act did a very dirty-minded thing and didn't even know it.
Mm.
The Support Act gave support, among other things, to a policy of the Veterans Administration that is grounded on their so-called opioid safety initiative. When you dig into the details, which almost none of the people who voted for this abomination did,
of course,
what you find out is that the opioid safety initiative is an excuse for forced tapering every vet that's on opioids to zero.
Oh my God. Wow.
And there's already data out there that VHS is sitting on because somebody in VHS tried to do a study of suicides among vets who were being prescribed opioids.
Mm-hmm.
And they found some pretty serious-looking data. There have been a lot of media reports, too. There was one poor fellow who was refused treatment at a veterans hospital, and he went out into the hospital parking lot and blew his brains out in his own car.
Yeah.
And he was not the only one who did.
No, I was going to say there's a number of stories like that. Yep.
Okay, so here's what happened. There was a conference going on in March of last year, March or April of last year, that VHS invites their people to go over significant issues in the VHS system. And one of the papers that was scheduled to be delivered was an analysis of the data they had collected on suicide among vets. What got fascinating was a couple of weeks before that conference occurred, the people who were going to present the paper were told, no, we're not going to bring this up until it's vetted.
Mm.
We got to go back and check all the data sets and be sure that what we got is real. And when that happened, the paper disappeared, and it hasn't surfaced since.
So that was just
and
a way
I've
of,
heard
yeah.
one fellow who says, well, they got vetted all right. They got it vetted 3 times, and they're still not releasing the paper.
Yeah. Just, yeah, that's the way
I don't
making
know
it disappear.
That's true,
yeah,
because I've never seen it from VHS.
Yeah,
but I do know VHS ought to have their butt put in a sling if they don't answer to it.
Right, right.
Now another thing, and this is also government.
Yeah,
the House Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee has an awful lot to say on issues like these. And I want to give them credit for having scheduled a hearing to hear from 4 commentators, one of whom was a pain patient advocate by the name of Cindy Steinberg. And they did this about a month ago, a little more than a month ago. I guess it was February something, and I can't think exactly what the date was. But they invited these people to talk to them about the issues that are raised by trying to be sure that pain patients get treated if they need to be treated with opioids, and that people who shouldn't have opioids don't get them.
Was this the hearing where the woman on the cot who testified?
That's the lady on the cot.
That's
Cindy
Steinberg?
The lady on the cot.
Gotcha, okay.
She's also one of the kindest people I've met, and I've talked with her person to person, face to face.
Yeah.
She's a pain patient who has actually had an impact. And she is a representative of the U.S. Pain Foundation. She's worked with them as an advocate and has some status in their organization. She's not just a person who subscribes to their newsletter.
Okay.
She's also had an impact on pain legislation in a few places. Massachusetts, I believe, or maybe Connecticut is one of them. And she's highly competent. She sits as the only patient advocate on the Health and Human Services Department Task Force on Best Practice for Pain Management, and she advocates for patients in that body. So she is by no means any slouch. She's a very competent and prepared advocate.
Mm-hmm.
Now, she didn't have to sit on a cot in this particular session, although she had in a past session.
Okay. That's a picture that I saw.
She sat at the table, and what she told the health committee was, guys, you got to take this mission away from CDC because they don't have any talent to do it.
Mm-hmm.
they're not the right people to do a guideline like this. And their guideline has produced absolutely horrendous consequences. It is driving doctors out of practice. It is putting patients at risk. If you're going to do this as a government exercise, for Pete's sakes, give the job to either the National Institutes of Health or the special office within the National Academies of Medicine that handles these things and that has resident staff that know what's at stake. And I don't know if her message was heard. I have not heard back from her or from anybody else on whether the health committee actually took her advice.
Right.
They should have.
Yeah.
But I don't know whether they did or not.
Yeah.
So for the folks that are listening and the folks that are on Facebook, there's a kind of there's a political action campaign here, as a matter of fact, but it doesn't have to be just with these people. And this is something I said last two times we talked, and I'm going to be a broken record on this, Matt. I'm sorry, but it's something
fine.
That needs to happen.
Absolutely, yeah.
If you can talk to family, even if you're in a situation where you don't trust your own words, you can ask a family member to do this for you. It's not hard to find out who your legislator is.
Right.
You can just do a Google search on my senator and the zip code.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, very
easy. Or my representative and the zip code. It'll bring up a link to the offices of that senator. And the first thing I'm going to tell you is, first of all, don't tell them Red Lawhern sent you. Second of all, don't send them email, because they can and do ignore most of the email I get, even if they send you a form letter.
Okay.
Nobody really reads them.
Right, right.
What you want to do is to find their Washington office phone number. And you want to call that number, and you want to say, I'm a chronic pain patient, or I am the caregiver of a chronic pain patient. Or if you're really brave and you're a doctor, I'm a doctor who treats chronic pain patients. And you are my senator, or your boss is my senator. You can talk to a staffer. You talk to the staffer and you say, your boss is my senator, or your boss is my representative. I vote in your district. And I want to tell you that your boss needs to help us fix a major problem. And that is, your boss needs to talk to his or her colleagues in the Senate or in the House. And between you need to introduce legislation that will direct the recall and the repudiation of the CDC guidelines on opioid prescription, and direct that some other task force go fix the mess these people made.
Right.
Because our lives are suffering because you won't do the right thing, and I expect you to get off your duff and do it.
Right. Exactly.
Now, I'm obviously using the kind of language I probably wouldn't use even with a staffer, because they're not the ones that are at fault on this. And
right.
You don't want to terrorize anybody or come across like a nutcase. You're not a nutcase. You're
right.
A person dealing with issues that millions of other people are dealing with.
Right. You want to speak calmly and no speaking of getting off duffs, necessarily. But I know I just said you want to speak calmly and no talk of getting off duffs necessarily, but encouraging them to take action, certainly. Yeah, you've
right.
got to. It's so important.
This is what I mean by empowerment, because the only reason pain patients are silent is that many of them have really hard time making the point with a lot of numbers, and you shouldn't have to make the point with a lot of numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Many of them are really hurting. Many of them are housebound or even bedbound because they've been denied appropriate treatment. And if you've been not denied treatment, it doesn't help you with the people who matter to simply write in social media. I mean, I realize that you want to be heard.
Right.
But the legislators aren't reading your media.
Exactly. Yeah, it's not enough. It's not enough to just do that.
And you got to get to them where they live, and that means getting to them in the offices where
right.
they live. In numbers.
Exactly. Actual
it's easy
civic
to
engagement.
Ignore one or two calls that might have happened or you might have heard about. It's a lot harder to ignore 100,000 calls the same day.
Right. Exactly.
And we've got enough people out there that we ought to be able to put 100,000 calls in those offices on the same day.
Right.
Let's make it April 1st.
There you go. Absolutely.
April Fool's Day. That was not accidental.
Right.
So make a commitment.
Right.
If you're a doctor or you're a patient or you're a family member of a patient and you're listening to this program, on April 1st, look up your representative and your governor's office.
Yes, absolutely.
And your state assemblyman's office, and you call them and you say, I'm a pain patient. I'm being denied treatment because of the CDC guidelines. I want you to take an active public stance to recall them and have them rewritten.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't have to be long, and it doesn't have to be
right.
teary, even though some people will tear up. Heck, yeah. I do. You just heard that
yeah.
a while back. But, I'm impassioned yeah. about this, and
absolutely.
Your passion matters. And if enough of us do the call, if enough of us call the editor of our city, largest city newspaper, and talk to their assistant, and say, hey, here's my situation. Maybe you ought to start putting in a few inquiries.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you ought to talk to the Alliance for the Treatment of Intractable Pain or MedPage or some of the other big media outlets and find out about April Fool's Day for pain patients.
Mm-hmm.
Because what we're going to do on April Fool's Day is we're going to tell these people how much they've damaged us.
Exactly. Exactly.
That's something that I find a very intriguing idea. And by the way, this is right off the top of my head. This is the first place anywhere that I've made this suggestion. So you got
oh,
this one, and you can
excellent.
Certainly post it on your page, and anybody else is welcome to make this one go viral. If
yeah.
you've got a Twitter account,
yeah,
go on your Twitter account and Twitter the phrase. April Fool's Day. Call your legislator.
Jenny says, call it Contact an Elected Fool Day. Well, we want to be a little bit diplomatic,
well,
though.
I'm but not going to go quite that
but
far.
That's pretty good. Red, let's just take a moment because Sandra Brewitt is listening online on Facebook. Linda Rollins made a comment I find interesting relating back to something you were talking about earlier. She says, my doctor wrote my script and then the pharmacist changed it by lowering the dose. I didn't know they were allowed to do that. That's interesting.
They're not.
Oh.
That can be reported to the State Board of Pharmacy as grounds for sanctioning the pharmacist.
Yeah.
He can refuse to fill it if in his judgment it's dangerous, but he can't unilaterally reduce the dose.
Okay.
If
yeah.
he does, he's in violation of the medical canons of ethics.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Interesting. Yeah. Like I said, I was surprised that that would even be allowed. So, okay, that's interesting.
Well, now here's a riff that takes off on where our commenter just left off.
Yeah.
Quite a number of pharmacists and chain pharmacies are publishing and sometimes sending in writing the policy of the chain pharmacy, and CVS is one of these, by the way.
Okay.
The policy of the pharmacy may be that they won't fill any prescription that goes over 90 MMED. I believe CVS has actually published that one.
Oh, okay.
To the doctors whose work they service, and I've heard complaints from multiple doctors that pharmacies in the CVS chain have called them and said, we're not going to accept any more of your prescriptions if they're over 90 MMED. And they did it because corporate headquarters told them to.
Oh, okay.
And
wow.
that violates the canons of medical ethics, too, because it places pharmacists in the position of becoming prescription authorities and prescribers of fact.
Right, right.
And that's flat out wrong.
So we got the government getting in between people and their doctors. We got the pharmacists doing it. It's not good. Jenny made a comment. She said, so it takes 2 weeks to die. Suck it up. If you have a non-curable disease, suck it up. In other words, she's saying, you know, this is what the attitude of the government is. You should meditate it away. It's all in your mind. You're an emotional woman. These are things that she's been told with her condition. Do you see a therapist? The short list of asinine comments said to one or others I know in the community. Yeah.
Well, there are responses to these things, because for every put down you get, you've also got an opportunity to set somebody straight.
Right.
And there are, you know, certain basic realities here. Now, let me give you one. One of the little scripts that I sometimes suggest to people is, well, you know, there really is a, there's something you're missing here. People in pain didn't make it happen for themselves, and people in pain are not addicts.
Right.
It is quite rare for somebody who's treated with medical opioids to have any problems with abuse at all. As a matter of fact, it is so rare that it's less than 1%. And many of the people that are in that 1% probably had opioid problems before they ever saw a doctor. There's another part of that that you can speak to. And mm-hmm. this is something I encourage every one of those that is on the website, excuse me, listening to your program, or working with on the Facebook page. You realize that no less an authority than the American Medical Association has published a resolution in their last, I think it was November of 2018 meeting, in which they said no doctor should ever be sanctioned or threatened with the loss of their license or threatened with investigation solely on the basis of the level of prescribing that they believe is necessary for their patients. There are patients for whom the appropriate treatment is higher than the level of safety review that was identified in the 2016 guidelines. And when you read that carefully, what you basically find out, what you basically realize, is that AMA has repudiated the core concepts in the CDC guidelines. And there are other doctors out there who have in fact said, and I'm not quite quoting this, this is sort of a summary of what they said. There are doctors out there who are highly prominent who are saying the CDC guidelines are actively dangerous. They are causing patient deaths.
They
are causing patients to be so horribly in pain that they go into the streets and kill themselves with things that are sold as prescription opioid pills and aren't, because there's too much fentanyl in them.
Yeah.
Illegal fentanyl in them.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a statistic here, and this was one that was quoted by the Pain Task Force on Best Practice. This was quoted in their open session. It's been estimated that at least 8.5% of all suicides occur among people who have been treated for severe pain. Now, suicide statistics are kind of fascinating. They are, I want to say, the third highest source of avoidable death in the U.S. That's a pretty big number.
Right.
And what it's saying is that a pretty substantial, noticeable part of that big number is people who have been treated at one time or another for chronic pain. And by implication, it is people who are now being denied treatment.
Right.
That's a harder statistic to put together, and CDC isn't even looking.
Right, right.
They're not trying to get an answer to this.
Yeah.
So that is chilling, but there's a ray of hope on this horizon, too. I want to be really careful to share this with listeners.
Yeah.
I sat in on all 4 days of the two public meetings that the HHS task force held. One of them was last May 29th and 30th, and the other was the 25th and 26th of September. And I heard all the proceedings, and I heard the members, there's 29 of them, the members of the task force speak to the principles that were being raised and were being discussed. I saw two panels of pain patients who had been assembled and who had appeared in person to speak to their experiences to the task force. And I heard what they said. And what they said was, in nicer language, the same thing I'm saying and have said for the last hour and a half. They were talking about their experiences of being stigmatized,
mm-hmm.
being called drug seekers, sometimes by emergency room nurses, by the way. That happens.
Oh, yeah. I've seen it. Yep. I've seen it
so
up close.
They were also talking about not being able to get adequate treatment. And they were talking about insurance companies that refuse to pay for massage therapy or acupuncture or counseling, reinforcement and counseling for depression, which is one of the most commonly occurring outcomes of chronic pain.
Oh.
Chronic pain just destroys life generally.
It just makes sense.
And
yeah.
The task force has heard them. The task force in December the 28th, I want to say, last year, published their draft recommendations to Congress. They were chartered by Congress to, under the CARA Act, and I still can't remember what the doggone alphabet stands for, but still, they were chartered by Congress to identify gaps, overlaps, and updates that were needed in published standards for pain management, published guidelines for pain management. And they went in and they really did a heck of a job on this. When they wrote their recommendations, the document is just over 100 pages long. It has over 400 references. And it piece by piece takes apart this field and looks at what is the prevailing standard and how does it need to be fixed?
Mm-hmm.
What is the prevailing practice guideline and how do we need to change it? Just the changes that they recommended is 60-odd pages long, and then you've got all the references and the glossary of terms that they put together. It is the most patient-centered document of its kind that I have ever read.
Yeah, I remember you mentioning that. Yeah.
Without quite saying so, and this is an area where I've put in serious comment to them. I'm working on this. Without quite saying so, if you read it very carefully, if you read the section that discusses the opioid guidelines of the CDC, what it says was that they screwed it up.
Right.
It's wrong. It needs to be changed. And the only really basic mistake they made was that because there is a member of the CDC staff on the task force, they weren't quite able in the draft to force themselves to go back out and say, somebody else needs to do this over because CDC doesn't know what they're doing.
Right, right.
That's kind of like poking their colleagues in the eye with a sharp stick.
Exactly, yeah.
And I don't blame anybody for being a little hesitant to do that, even though as a patient advocate, I think I'm at liberty to.
Yeah, I mean, it would still be the right thing to do, whether it's difficult or not. That's, you know.
Well, yeah, and it's politically difficult. Yeah. And there's all sorts of politics being played with this, to some extent because of the reasoning that you offer, because people want to look like they're doing something.
Right.
There's another piece of this, as a matter of fact. Let me really try to be fair about this.
Mm-hmm.
There is a genuine opioid crisis in America. It's real.
Mm-hmm.
There are something on the order of 1.5 million to 2 million people who have an addiction problem,
right.
A really major problem that they can't really control. Because what addiction is an obsessive or compulsive need to take opioids, even though you know they're wrecking your life.
Right.
There are about 2 million people out there who have that problem. Now, a few of those people started out by abusing alcohol and prescription drugs that they stole from a home medicine closet, or that a friend of theirs gave them, or a relative gave them because they had a temporary pain problem and they took too much.
Right.
A few of them really did start that way. But the preponderance of evidence we have is that people who understand addiction don't believe that any large number of people have a problem that is only with opioids.
Right.
We know that there is reason for caution and for frequent oversight. when somebody's opioid dose increases and increases and increases. We need to be careful about that.
Right.
Because people do become dependent on opioids, even when they need them, when they actually need them.
Right.
For pain.
Yeah. And it's probably smart to clarify that.
Opioid dependence is not opioid addiction. And people who have a right to have a real opinion on this, and that includes FDA and NIDA, they know that, and they are saying that.
Yeah.
And the guidelines the task force recommendations are very clear on that.
Yes.
The place where the guidelines kind of got, or the task force kind of got off on track, was they were also affected by the public narrative that keeps yammering away at this unsupported idea that prescriptions are the problem. But I would say to the task force, and I'd say it right here, and they've heard me say it before, some of them heard me say it face-to-face, prescriptions didn't start this mess.
Mm-hmm.
And prescriptions are not sustaining it. And we know that beyond any reasonable contradiction. The two charts you're carrying on your Facebook page are part of that knowledge.
Yeah.
And so what we need to be saying to people, and what the task force has come closer than any other body I've ever read to saying, is we know that there is an opioid crisis in this country. We know that there are enough people who are unemployable because they're nodding off on illegal drugs, that it's actually affecting our life expectancy as a nation. That's real. That's true.
Yeah,
and what is the answer to it?
That number's
well,
gone down.
It ain't going to come cheap. And it doesn't involve uncritically restricting opioids to people for whom they are the only answer.
Right.
It involves money, and it involves money bigger than so far you've been willing to stick your nose out and realize. Because the reason why people are vulnerable to opioids in non-medical use is that the American economy is putting them out of work and destroying their families and destroying their communities.
Mm-hmm.
The American economy needs to have a really hard look given to it, and the stigma and bias and errors in our understanding of both addiction and chronic pain need to have some understanding devoted to them. And what we really need to be trying to do is harm reduction.
Mm-hmm.
Because as far as we know, the only really effective treatment for addiction is medication-assisted therapy. And that basically means methadone or naloxone or buprenorphine. It is methadone or bup, if you will.
Okay.
Those are the only two means that we have to help interrupt this terrible cycle of hopelessness in people who are already addicted. We got to start educating fourth graders.
Oh, yeah.
Say no. And there are some states that are doing this, as a matter of fact. The state of South Carolina has already got a program in place that delivers 40 hours during the school year of education about what are addictive drugs and how do you control your own life and your own feelings well enough not to need them for just getting along when you don't really have a medical problem.
Right.
South Carolina is doing that. Several other states are doing it too.
Yeah.
Now, unfortunately, the Trump administration isn't really facing up honestly to the problem.
That doesn't surprise me.
You're going to have to do jobs retraining in addition to medication-assisted therapy.
Yeah.
And you're going to have to build safe, sober housing for people that are just coming out of addiction.
Right.
And you're going to have to stop sending people to prison whose only crime is a drug-related, non-violent crime.
Oh, amen to
we
that.
We know that when people come out of prison who have been exposed to opioids, they have a hugely higher rate of overdose-related death because they go right back into the same communities without assistance and without support.
Right.
That they came out of when they went into prison in the first place.
Absolutely.
So these things are understood. They're understood very widely, and people who have tried to make that point to the Trump administration have not been heard.
Yeah.
Instead, what the National Office for Drug Control has done is they've gone out with a PR campaign that basically says prescriptions are the problem, suppress them.
Yeah, well,
that campaign
people
is
like
not
simple
supported
messages
by the medical community, and it should not be.
Right. Red, before we run out of
time.
They
got to go back and get a lot of things right. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, that's okay. And by the way, hello to Ben Dion and Daryl Dion are here in the studio with us, I guess.
How's it going?
They're coming up next with the weekly Dion. But before we run out of time, Red, I do want to just get a couple of these Facebook comments in that are in the Facebook live chat. Christy Aller says, I was sobbing in front of my neurologist in pain, and I told him I didn't want to live in pain anymore, and he never acknowledged my pain. Instead, he suggested for me to go to a psychiatric hospital. I needed my pain acknowledged and dealt with. My pain can't be dealt with until the CDC guidelines are rewritten. The CDC guidelines have our physicians scared witless, like we talked about earlier. Anita Spiro said, I can say for myself, it's taken away my my business, my livelihood, my dignity, my relationship with my family and friends. I gave up the right to drive because I can't move safely. I don't sleep, eat, and I'm gaining weight. Stress from the pain has caused high blood pressure with opiates, which I was on for years, same dose. I started a business. I could drive, hold my grandchildren, and more. I just want to be a productive part of society. And again, that reminds me specifically of what my mother's gone through. Jenny mentions ketamine for pain management. Christy says Trump needs to be way more open than just his narrow viewpoint. I'm not going to hold my breath with that. Okay. And finally, Linda says CPPs have been grouped with addicts. So in my mission to try to get us out, I started working with addicts as there is a crisis. So and Red, I'll let you respond to anything you want there quickly, and then I also want to make sure we before we run out of time, we get in where people can go and what they should do online to, you know, maybe reach out to you and follow what you're doing and all that. But go ahead and respond to anything there.
Well, first of all, the messages that are being shared in your chat room are messages that I hear every week. So what I want to say to those who have taken the time to comment, who have been kind enough to share their experience, is you're not alone.
Yeah.
There are hundreds of thousands of people just like you out there. And I'm not the only one working on this. When there's a Facebook page you can come to if you want to, that's the Alliance for the Treatment of Intractable Pain. And if you do a search on that term up in the window on the top left of your Facebook page, you'll find it.
Yeah.
That group is supported by medical professionals who are not visible in the page, and they can't prescribe for you or send you to somebody who does reliably prescribe for you, but they can give you accurate information.
Okay.
And some of that information is in white papers that we've done. I've published quite a large number myself, part of them with ATIP, which we sometimes call, and some of them on my own. I have over 70 published papers now. If you want to find me and the kind of work that I do and my published work, it's really easy. You can do a Google search for the term the Lawhern Files. It's Lawhern, Lawhern Files. That will take you very directly in one of the top hits to an archive of my published work. That includes some videos. It includes some of our past podcasts here on Matt's program. It'll take you to the presentation I gave September 25th to the task force in Washington. It's 3 minutes, and it bites real hard because it tells people there's a lot of things you got to get over. And as medical professionals, the first one is the silly idea that prescribing causes the problem, because it doesn't.
Right.
But you'll see it. That video has had well over 60,000 viewings since it was put out by somebody else. I hadn't even realized it was out until somebody pointed it out to me.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So there is that. Now, the other part of this is make a note on your calendar. April 1st is Tell Your Legislature What's Happening to You Day.
Mm-hmm.
Or perhaps tell the fool, if you want to call it that, tell the fools what's happened to you, Dave.
Yes.
And, you know, keep it short, keep it straight.
Concise, yep.
But don't stop. Do it with your senators. Do it with your representative. Do it with your governor's office.
Yes.
Or with the state Board of Medicine. You can find them on a phone call, too.
Yeah.
And you can go to the ATIP Facebook page, and you can tell them, what did you hear? What happened?
Yeah.
If you try to tell me what happened, I'm going to drown in it, because if we do this right, there's going to be so many messages I can't even begin to respond to.
Right, exactly.
And that's fine.
Yeah, yeah. Good problem to have in a sense. But by the way, Jenny did share the direct link, so people don't even have to look for it for ATIP right in the Facebook live chat. So you can just click that link and go right to it. And hello to Ed Murphy.
Let me tell you
too.
A little bit about ATIP. Right now, we have a network of 300 pain patients.
We got to be fairly quick, Red, just so you know.
All right. We have about 300 pain patients and 100 journalists and doctors.
Okay.
And if we need to make something known, we can get the word out in 15 minutes to that whole group. And in just a little bit more, to about 40,000 people on Facebook and 200,000 on Twitter. So this is we're willing to hear from you, and we're happy to hear from you, and we're going to go right on trying to help.
Wow, that is awesome. That is awesome. All right, Red. Well, listen, once again, you have been extraordinarily generous with your time, and we really, really appreciate it very much. And, you know, as I said, you know, this has become, you know, because of my mother, this has become a very personal issue to me. So I really appreciate it. And, man, you're still now getting tons of love online for your activism and all that you do, so which is awesome.
Send me a link to your chat room. I haven't been tuned into it, but I'd like to go back and look and see what happened.
Oh, definitely. And I know that's not why you do it. I know you're doing it to help people, but still, it's nice that they appreciate everything that you do, and I appreciate it, and I know Jenny appreciates it, and you know, we'll do this again, and you know, we'll keep hammering this until we can get the changes made that have to happen, that are so important, so people aren't suffering. But Red, once again, thank you so much, my friend.
You're quite welcome, and I'll come back anytime you think it makes sense.
Wonderful. Okay, thanks. Take care. Bye bye.
Bye now.
All right, that was the great Red Lawhern, and if you miss any part of that, it will be up in just a few minutes at WMNHradio.org. And Daryl, how are you?
Excellent. How are you doing today?
Good, good. What do you guys have coming up on the Weekly Die-On?
Actually, we have a former student of Ben's, Nick Britton. He graduated, I think, a couple of years ago. He's now attending, not really sure, so I don't want to say. I think Dartmouth, but I'm not 100% sure. But I was one of those folks at the Beto O'Rourke event this morning.
Oh, very nice.
Wall to wall, folks.
I bet, yeah.
It was, most of us thought it was unusual for him to have such an event at such a small venue.
Yeah.
Consuelos is, it's pretty small.
That's right.
And
right.
We were packed in pretty good.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's so funny. I was part of the first third of the people that were in line.
Yeah.
And as we were talking through the morning, we were waiting for about, I think he showed up about 10:30.
Yeah.
So we waited about an hour and a half. And, her theory was that because we were in the front of the line, we were going to be in the back of the room.
Yeah.
It's exactly what happened.
Oh, really? Yeah.
So I was about...
That figures.
Exactly. I was about 3 feet away from trying to get a photo, a selfie.
Yeah, yeah.
Didn't happen. But he spoke very succinctly. I like what he says. He spoke eloquently in both Spanish and English.
Okay.
You know, which I thought was also very cool.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I lived in El Paso, so I think...
right.
And apparently that's part of the curriculum back in Texas, that you need to speak two languages.
Oh, I bet...
It makes perfect sense.
I bet the conservatives hate that, though.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I bet it drives them nuts, which makes me chuckle.
Even more. Absolutely. Absolutely. So it was a fun time.
Cool.
They did serve... I didn't take any because I just didn't want to.
Yeah.
But the restaurant owner served... hot chocolate.
Oh, okay.
Mexican type of hot chocolate.
Yeah.
Apparently, it was very good.
Oh.
All of it that came my way, I just passed it back and forth and stuff.
Well, good for you. You're very disciplined. That's good.
It was, I had my water.
There you go.
So it was a good event. It was good.
All right, very good. Well, everybody stick around for the weekly Dion with, of course, hosted by Ben Dion and his dad, Daryl. And once again, thank you, Red Lawhern. Thank you to everybody who participated in the Facebook live chat. And I will talk at y'all a little bit later. Bye, everybody.
Political action committees. Is there anything that legally prevents me from doing that?
No.
Mrs. Hobart Flynn, is there any hard limit that I have in terms of what legislation I'm allowed to touch? Are there any limits on the laws that I can write based on the special interest funds that I accepted to finance my campaign and get me elected in the first place?
There's no limit.
So there's none. So I can be totally funded by oil and gas. I can be totally funded by Big Pharma. Come in, write Big Pharma laws, and there's no limits to that whatsoever.
That's right.
Okay, so...
The problem with politics is corporate banditry. No other problems.